Welcome to the first session in the webinar series, Applying Best Practices to Diverse Older Adults, sponsored by the Stanford Geriatric Education Center in collaboration with the California Area Health Education Centers, American Geriatrics Society, and Natividad Medical Center. My name is Christopher Matola, and I will be your host for the session. We are very happy to have you join with us today as we present the program on Best Practices in Health Education and Nutrition for Diverse Older Patients with Diabetes. If you have questions during the presentation, please use the chat feature on the screen to write them. The presenters will respond to the questions in the Q&A session at the end of their presentations. If you need to communicate with the presenters directly after the session, you may do so by sending an email to Stanford GEC at stanfordgec@stanford.edu. At the conclusion of the webinar, please complete the short evaluation questionnaire. For those of you who have requested continuing education credits for attending the webinar, the evaluation is required. We need to let you know that the webinar is not supported by any commercial interest, and today's presenters have no financial relationships to disclose. And now, to introduce our new 2012 webinar series, is our Stanford Geriatric Education Center webinar coordinator, Dr. Kala Mehta.
On behalf of the Stanford Geriatric Education Center and our partners, the American Geriatric Society, the California Area Health Education Centers, and Natividad Medical Center, welcome to our first webinar series devoted to best practices in the care of diverse older adults. Our focus today is on diabetes. Here at Stanford, we are fortunate to have Hal Holman and Kate Lorig, who, together with Ed Wagner in Seattle, helped to develop the evidence-based best practice in caring for patients with chronic illness. As you may recall, in Wagner's chronic care model, depicted here, the best practice includes a prepared, proactive practice team. Today, we present some tools that your teams can use with ethnic elders diagnosed with diabetes. I am very pleased to introduce my colleagues, Leticia Mendoza and Carolyn Fee. Leticia Mendoza is currently the Senior Diabetes Clinical Nurse Specialist and Clinical Diabetes Educator at Stanford Hospital and Clinics, and she's the go-to person for our difficult diabetic patients. After being a bedside nurse in the cardiac ICU for 5 years, in 2009, she received a Master's of Science in Advanced Community and International Nursing, and she plans to get her PhD. Carolyn H.B. has taught at San Jose State University for 21 years. Her area of specialization are multicultural health, geriatric nutrition, and health promotion. She has been a valued colleague here at the Stanford GEC since 1992. After Ms. Mendoza's and Dr. Fee's presentations, Dr. Nancy Morioka-Douglas, clinical professor of family medicine and co-director of the SGEC, will be joining us to help answer any questions. I will now turn the microphone to our first speaker, Ms. Mendoza.
Hi, good afternoon, and thank you for joining us today for learning more about MS geriatric patients with diabetes. Thank you to Dr. Markham Douglas and all staff at SGEC for organizing the 2012 webinar series. Today's learning objectives are to better understand the problems of and special skills with MS geriatric patients with diabetes, understand the role of certified diabetes educators in the treatment of MS geriatric patients with diabetes, and deploying truly resource search managers for treatment of MS geriatric patients with diabetes. Diabetes is an important health condition for the aging population, especially considering that the U.S. population is aging out. 2.9 million or 10 million people in the U.S. are diabetic. It is estimated that by 2030, the number of older Americans will have more than doubled to 70 million, or about one in every five Americans. The care of older adults with diabetes is complicated by the clinical and functional heterogeneity, and diabetes represents a heavy medical, human, and socioeconomic burden for the elderly people. Here are the national estimates of racial and ethnic differences in diagnosed diabetes for some of the minority groups. 12.6% of non-Hispanic blacks, 11.8% of Hispanics, 8.4% of Asian Americans, and 7.1% of non-Hispanic whites are diagnosed with diabetes. The statistics, therefore, show that diabetes is more common in ethnic elders. Age-related factors may interfere with self-management of diabetes, as most people over age 70 years old will have some deterioration in their mental and physical functioning, even if their ability to learn may not be impaired. As a matter of fact, the CDC reports that people with diabetes aged 60 years or older are 2 to 3 times more likely to report an inability to walk 1/4 of a mile, to climb stairs, or do housework compared to people without diabetes. Diabetes management in the elderly is complicated by higher rates of premature death, functional disability, and coexisting illnesses such as hypertension, coronary artery disease, stroke, and arthritis than those people without diabetes. Physical changes, which include those such as an elevated renal glucose threshold, and more commonly and most challenging are the dexterity, visual, and auditory impairments, social and physical circumstances. Many times a support system is lacking in the elderly, financial status, limited income, they are faced with high cost of medication, and language barriers, their inability to communicate effectively with their healthcare providers or understand the treatment plan, and depression. The elderly are at higher risk for geriatric syndromes, such as polypharmacy. Many older persons with diabetes require diabetes medication, and they are frequently on many or multiple combinations of medications. Depression, people with diabetes are twice as likely to have depression, which can further complicate diabetes management. Cognitive impairment, urinary incontinence, injurious fall, and persistent or chronic pain are also important risk factors to keep in mind. People of all ages with diabetes need to have an accurate diagnosis and a diabetes treatment plan that is tailored to their specific situation and that includes diabetes self-management education and training. Some challenges include the identification of appropriate treatment goals for the elderly with diabetes, recognizing their symptoms of hyper or hypoglycemia, achieving adequate self-glucose monitoring. This can be very challenging with patients with visual and manual dexterity problems, understanding diabetes treatment options, meeting their individual needs, and preventing or delaying complications of diabetes in the elderly. For older persons, the American Geriatric Society, or the AGS, the standard of care is individualized treatment with a focus on quality of life. Both the American Diabetes Association and the American Geriatric Society agree that older adults who are relatively healthy and are functional and cognitively intact and have a significant life expectancy, their hemoglobin A1C goal should be less than 7% or the same goal that was developed for younger adults or younger patients. For frail older adults with life expectancy of less than 5 years or with functional and cognitive decline with multiple comorbidities, the hemoglobin A1C goal can be relaxed, and for the AGS, it is appropriate to have it below 8%. However, the risk of acute hyperglycemic complications should be avoided in all patients. causes of uncontrolled hyperglycemia in the elderly are directly related to food and hydration, as your ability to obtain and prepare food diminishes. Physical activity is also decreased in the elderly due to visual and or physical issues. Oral medication, adherence to medication regimens tends to be poor in older persons, and it could be related to factors such as high cost of medications, avoidance of side effects such as hypoglycemia. Many new medications out there are very expensive, and the older patients tend to be on Medicare and oftentimes called the clinic saying that they cannot afford the medication. Insulin dosing is challenging because of poor vision, which can make dosing of insulin very difficult. It can lead to incorrect withdrawal of insulin. Storage is also important because expired medications are often found in the medication boxes of our elderly patients. And it is also noted that many times insulin is not stored at the right temperature. Injection technique is also very important, and it is important to assess the patient's injection technique and ability to self-inject insulin injections, have the patient demonstrate injections in the clinic, including sites, and assess or check for hypertrophies or other injection issues. Presenting signs of diabetes in the elderly are often quite different from those expected in younger people. Because of an increasing renal glucose threshold with increasing age, the polyuria and subsequent polydipsia, typical diabetes are often not seen even with blood glucose levels that are well above 200. Some of the signs and symptoms of hyperglycemia in the elderly include polyphagia, polydipsia, blurred vision, new or increased confusion, lethargy, weight loss, worsening incontinence, and fruity breath order. Now, switching over to another important issue with the elderly is hypoglycemia. Symptoms of hypoglycemia may also differ in older people from those seen in younger people. The most common symptoms consist of nonspecific neurological signs, notably disorientation, falls, or sudden changes in behavior. These symptoms may have severe consequences, particularly when they are unrecognized as a result of hypoglycemia. Therefore, atypical signs and symptoms such as falls or behavior changes should warrant further testing for hypoglycemia. Diabetic patients with moderate or severe cognitive disorders are often incapable of recognizing these symptoms of low blood sugars and therefore incapable of treating hypoglycemia. The most important risk factor for hypoglycemia are situations of reduced food intake, which may be secondary to intercurrent disease, or a change in their setting of care, such as a recent hospital stay, or transition to a skilled nursing facility. Some comorbidities that are also risk factors for hypoglycemia include renal failure, and cognitive and psychiatric disorders, which can lead to errors in their medication administration and or their food intake. Diabetes self-management education and training for older adults with diabetes should consider the individual's life expectancy, functional status, and the presence of cognitive changes, as well as the individual's preferred learning style, language, literacy, and including health literacy. And the seven self-care behaviors of diabetes self-management education and training are healthy eating, being active, monitoring, taking medication, problem solving, reducing risk, and healthy coping. Nutrition is very important in diabetes control. And in my opinion and with my experiences, it can be very complex for the elderly patients. Diet control can be very difficult when the patients lack teeth or well-fitting dentures. They cannot afford nutritious foods or are unable to understand the diet instructions, as well as the importance of food and medication with the timing of their insulin or oral medications. Social factors also play a role in the older person's eating habits, such as eating meals alone. It is easier for them to eat a bowl of cereal 3 times a day rather than to cook a well-balanced meal. Eating out also may also result in the patient eating high-calorie, high-fat, high-sodium foods, as well as frozen dinners, which are commonly seen in our elderly population. Social programs such as Meals on Wheels may be helpful. And shortly, Ms. Caroline B. will provide us with more insight in regards to diabetes and nutrition for the elderly. Exercise for the elderly may be more problematic than for younger persons, as certain health conditions such as cardiovascular disease and arthritis are more likely to be present. However, regular physical activity can help maintain physical and emotional health in the elderly with diabetes by lowering their glucose levels, therefore supporting cardiovascular health, improving strength, balance, and flexibility, and enhancing a sense of well-being, as well as a positive mood. Diabetes educators conduct clinical and cognitive assessments that include cardiovascular status, comorbid conditions, other risks associated with frailty, and the possibility of hypoglycemia. Therefore, medications should be also assessed. And activity goals are set collaboratively to reflect the individual's abilities, interests, and physical barriers. Self-monitoring of blood glucose, foot checks, blood pressure, weight, and exercise frequency are essential components of self-management. Successful meter operation is dependent on adequate vision and manual dexterity of the patient. Therefore, assessing for glucose meter that a person will be able to use and that will meet their physical and mental abilities is very important. For example, the one-touch ultra-2 meter can be programmed in Spanish, and this is a great example to use with patients whose primary language is Spanish. There are many new blood glucose monitoring devices for patients with visual impairments, such as talking meters. And I know that the Prodigy does provide a speaking meter in Spanish as well. And there are meters with a backlight, which can help the patients distinguish the blood sugar results. Adherence to medication regimens tend to be poor in older persons and must be assessed frequently. Common causes of non-adherence in older adults include decreased vision, hearing, and dexterity, cognitive impairment, stress and depression, polypharmacy. Since the elderly are on many medications, it is good practice to ask patients to bring all their medication bottles to the clinic for review, economic limitations, and avoidance of adverse effects, such as hypoglycemia. For patients with visual or dexterity problems, magnifiers that clip onto the syringes are available, and so are the 50-unit and 30-unit disposable syringes that have wider spaces between the unit markings to help with the measurement of smaller doses of insulin. Also, family members can assist patients with pre-filling insulin syringes or look into the option of pre-filled insulin pens in which the patient can manually turn the knob and see the number of units that they will be injecting. Memory and ability, their ability to follow complex instructions change in normal aging. Therefore, it is important to remember that older persons may fatigue more easily and experience difficulty with complex thinking. It is important to use plain language, simple organization, and concrete examples with this population. And if dementia is advanced, adequate diabetes self-management will require assistance from family or other caregivers. The use of appropriate education materials is also very important. It is important to keep in mind the patient's primary language, use large and or bold print, and use pictures. This is where the educators can become very creative in helping the patient to learn. A use of glucose log books may also help the patient remember to check blood sugars and take medications regularly. This will keep a track record and help them look for trends. Frequent and regular follow-up with the diabetes educator is also essential, and this can also include telephone follow-ups, as many elderly patients have trouble getting to the doctor appointments. Managing diabetes is very stressful, and it is more stressful and overwhelming for the elderly. In older persons, this stress may be magnified, and it's lessened by psychosocial support due to losses of spouse or peers, financial independence, and their mobility. Addressing psychosocial issues is important for healthy coping. Older persons with diabetes in acute care settings do not have control over their food choices, timing of meals and medications, and it is important that survival skills are be assessed and taught as needed. Survival skills including knowing the medications, when they're working the hardest, which ones should be taken with meals, and as well as self-monitoring of blood sugars would be really important for these patients. It is also known that racial and ethnic disparities exist in terms of burden of disease, quality of health care, and health outcomes. Minority patients often report not completely understanding their provider's recommendations, often feeling that their provider did not listen to them, or having questions but not asking them during the visit. And this could be because they may feel embarrassed to admit they don't understand the treatment plan or felt that they weren't listened to. Patients with limited resources, low literacy levels, or learning disabilities are sometimes labeled as non-compliant. Minority patients have consistently reported more communication problems during healthcare visits compared to whites. Signs of low literacy, such as when the patient states that they cannot read material in the clinic because they forgot their glasses, frequently missed appointments, or errors in medication administration may be signs of low health literacy. Therefore, clear communication is key in providing culturally competent care. In the interest of time, I will present one example of a recent challenging patient case of a Mexican-American patient seen in our clinic. This was a 82-year-old Mexican male with very limited English proficiency who is widowed, lives with his son in a rural farm working community with no local resources. Son assists him with all his ADL, and his son has a low health literacy, reports a fifth grade education. Patient is challenged with vision impairment. His diet is high in carbohydrates, consists of potatoes, bread, tortilla, rice, and beans, and they live on a limited fixed income. The patient was diagnosed with a new onset diabetes, requiring basal bolus insulin regimen. It was noted that the patient's blood sugars were highly variable, running from 40 to 400. Self-monitoring of blood glucose is therefore essential in this patient. Here are some more facts in regards to Mexican Americans with type 2 diabetes. The prevalence of diabetes is twice as high among Mexican Americans than among non-Latino whites in the U.S. Mexican Americans tend to have more severe diabetes and they experience the disease onset at earlier ages. Mexican Americans comprise the largest and fastest growing U.S. Latino subgroup, and thus the need for effective, culturally appropriate interventions to support diabetes management among Mexican Americans is necessary. When working with Mexican-American patients, it is important to keep in mind some of the most common diabetes-related beliefs and practices among this group. Many believe that diabetes can be caused by an intense fright or trauma, also known as susto. Insulin can cause blindness or organ damage. The use of alternative therapies, such as bulk remedies, and consulting a bulk healer or curanderos is also very common. And they view shared disease management, which is very strong. It's a very strong McLean culture value for family mismo, so they share the disease management. And here are some tips that have shown positive outcomes in previous studies when working with Mexican-American patients, which include the use of Spanish, discussion of ethnic Latino foods, which will be addressed in the next lecture by Mrs. Caroline Fee, inclusion of Latino music, and the use of Latino staff when possible. And referring back to the patient case, the following interventions were used in order to provide individualized treatment. Addressing the language barrier by utilizing medical interpreters, advocating for simplified regimens for the patient, teaching the survival skills, which include self-monitoring of blood sugars, signs and symptoms of hypo and hyperglycemia, timing of insulin and food. Addressing the visual impairment by assessing whether the patient would benefit from insulin pens versus a syringe or vial. Consider the talking meter for this patient. It is important to know that insurance might request a prior authorization or a medical justification in order to get this special diabetic supply approved. Financial barriers, refer the patient to the social worker, advocate for resources such as in-home support services, Meals on Wheels, home health nurse, and cultural tailoring, especially to their diet preferences, and close follow-up with the diabetes team, which can include a certified diabetes educator, diabetes nurse, physician, and primary care physician. The endocrinologist, because most of these patients tend to be followed by a diabetes expert in the beginning and as needed. And arrange adequate time for education as needed that is appropriate to the patient's needs, and this can include telephone follow-ups as well. And here are more resources for patients with diabetes, where they can find local support groups and community resources by visiting the American Diabetes Association, diabetes.org. And they can also find a certified diabetes educator on the website of the American Association of Diabetes Educators.
Yeah, I'm going to start her right now. I'm going to hand you the ball, Caroline, and see if I find her.
I'm delighted to follow Ms. Mendoza in that excellent and very complete overview of all the different types of areas and modalities to treat our ethnogeriatric patients. My area that I'm going to drill down into will be, again, best practices, but this time drilling into nutrition counseling and treatment for ethnogeriatric patients with diabetes. The learning objectives for my part will be looking at dietary treatment of ethnogeriatric patients, understanding the importance of cultural values, applying cultural-specific nutrition resources and strategies, and understanding the role of registered dietitians and certified diabetes educators. I'd like to begin by emphasizing the importance of building on cultural values. We know that dietary treatment includes not only standard nutrition food choice and frequency evaluation, but also, to be effective, paying attention to traditional cultural values, especially among those elders who are less acculturated. I'd like to give you just one example. In Mexican-American ethno-geriatric population, using these cultural values, the first one would be personalismo, which is the importance of using personal relations. This means when meeting the patient, learning a little bit about them first before you're getting down to business. Some establishing rapport, some small talk, maybe asking about someone's family or the weather, something that makes the person feel that you really care about them and they're not just a medical case. The second cultural value is respeto, which is showing respect to elders who are traditionally valued in Mexican society. This certainly involves using formal names, señor, señora, or Mr. and Mrs., and any other areas that you can make an extra point of showing that you respect the elder. The next cultural value is familismo. This is the importance of emphasizing the value of and reliance on the family. This can be a very strong motivation to encourage elders to accept dietary changes that they need in order to help their diabetes. So I'd like to talk just a moment more about familismo and diet therapy. What we have found is that if we emphasize healthier diets for the entire family, rather than isolating the elder and making them feel like a burden on their family. And then using the family support for dietary changes so that these healthier diets are going to be helpful not only for the diabetes treatment for the elder, but healthier for the grandchildren and the adult children in the family. The family then can use support for one another's dietary changes. Things like eating more vegetables and fruits and less fat, types of things that would help every member in the family. Most important, involving a family member who does the grocery shopping and the cooking. This will be the key person that needs to be involved in all the counseling and education efforts. And then focusing on preferred cultural foods. For this to happen, we need culturally specific nutrition education resource modules. Those that could give a cultural perspective, traditional food habits, acculturation issues, contemporary food habits, and counseling considerations. One of the best resources that I have found is a book called Food and Culture. It is by Kittler, Sucher, and Nelms, and I have the citation here at the bottom of the slide. This book that I just referred to, Culture and Health, has an extensive collection of ethnic groups. I've just chosen one for an example, which is the Mexican-American ethno-geriatric example, looking at, first of all, traditional foods. Staples include corn and beans. Some very common fruits, bananas, guava, mango, papaya, pineapple. Some very popular vegetables, avocados, squash, cactus or nopales, chili peppers, tomatoes, onions, and salsa. Looking at grains, corn and corn products are highly preferred, certainly tortillas and masa used for things like tamales. Long grain rice, usually prepared with vegetables, sometimes called Spanish rice or Mexican rice, European-style breads and rolls, and pan dulce, which is a Mexican sweet bread. Some dairy products that are popular include cheese, often put on the top of certain dishes like enchiladas, and crema, which is a Mexican cream that's used for topping, much like we use sour cream in the more mainstream traditions. Some common protein sources include beans, meat prepared with chili peppers and vegetables, commonly in a mixed dish, carne asada, grilled beef, chorizo, a spicy sausage, and eggs. Now, the next thing that's very important is to look at the acculturation of that traditional diet to the mainstream American diet. So when you are trying to assess acculturation, you need to consider the length of residence in the U.S., the person's age, education and income level, and their ability to speak English. It is often that ethno-geriatric patients and people are less acculturated than younger generations, especially if they have not been born in the U.S. However, many of our ethno-geriatric patients live with their adult children, and these adult children can often be more acculturated to the mainstream American diet. So with acculturation, consumption of many traditional dishes decrease while many new foods are added. And some Mexican-American examples would include flour tortillas, plain cooked rice, white bread, ice cream, cookies, salad dressing, mayonnaise, margarine, and sodas. These are just some examples of our mainstream American diet that are higher in fat, sugar, and refined carbohydrates, which are postulated as risk factors for a number of diseases, including type 2 diabetes. So let's look now at some strategies for dietary changes. Making healthy food choices is where we begin. Certainly choosing foods that are lower in total fat, especially saturated fat, cholesterol, and trans fats that are found in processed foods. Increasing the intake of complex carbohydrates, particularly whole grains, fresh vegetables and fruits, and low-fat sources of protein, for example, beans, lean meats, fish, and poultry. And in our Mexican-American example, a focus on a return to their traditionally healthy foods. In addition, and this is where we get can sort of drill down even more into the ethno-geriatric patient who needs to have controlled and measured amounts of different foods, it is very important to teach serving sizes and portion control so that the whole family may be eating the same foods, but in the diabetic management, certain proportions and sizes are very important. In the nutrition field, we use food replicas. And I have a reference for that at the end of this presentation. They are very helpful in showing serving sizes and amounts. For ethnic elders, we can also use ethno-specific food guides like My Plate to discuss adequate servings and recommended choices from each food group. Our latest from the USDA is called My Plate. The one in green, the placemat in green, is the generic My Plate. You'll see that half of the plate consists of fruits and vegetables, a little more than the other half grains, particularly whole grains, and then the smallest little section there, protein. And there is also a circle up at the top that shows the importance of dairy foods, particularly the calcium that they contain. There is a mitlato, the Spanish version of My Plate. It is actually the same in proportions. The only difference would be that it is in Spanish, but that the dairy circle has the a red flag for lactose. Many Mexican-Americans have lactose intolerance and so are not able to digest some of the dairy products. My personal preference is the Mexican food plate that actually comes from Mexico. And I'd like to go over it just for a second and maybe point out why I think it's perhaps more helpful. It's divided into thirds. The top third would be the vegetables and fruits with the term muchas. These are the things that, for health reasons, we focus on. the next area, going sort of counterclockwise here, are the cereales. These would be the grains. There are many cultural examples, as there were with the fruits and vegetables, which I think makes people feel more respected and understood if you can talk about their particular cultural preferences. The last third, which I find most interesting, is these would be the protein third, but if you look closely, over half of that last protein third are vegetable proteins, beans, peas, that, nuts, that type of thing, legumes. Certainly low fat, high complex carbohydrate, and the smaller part of that last section in protein has the animal protein products. And in this particular model, the dairy is actually included in this animal protein section. So regardless of what food model you use, modifying cultural recipes is absolutely essential. So let me give you some Mexican-American strategies using cultural foods, but then modifying them and making them healthier for the entire family and, of course, the ethnogeriatric patient as well. Using corn tortillas instead of flour. Consuming boiled beans instead of refried with added fat. Adding more vegetables to mixed dishes. Using low-fat dairy products, certainly low-fat cheeses for toppings. And we've found that low-fat sour cream can be a much healthier substitution for the La Crema, which is a full-fat dairy product. Using fruits, raw or baked, for dessert. If you've ever never had some a baked piece of pineapple or a baked banana, you're in for a treat. They're very delicious. Preparing poultry, fish, and lean meats grilled instead of fried. Use low-fat cooking methods like baking or microwaving, and particularly tortilla chips. By cutting up a corn tortilla and crisping them in the oven, you can avoid all added fat. And also the microwave is a wonderful way to soften tortillas and to cook vegetables for a mixed dish without adding any fat at all. And when using any kind of frying method, using small amounts of vegetable oil instead of lard, which is a cultural a source of fat that is sometimes used. Before we end of talking about the Mexican-American traditional healthy diet, there are other examples of traditional diets that aren't as healthy. One example would be the African-American traditional diet, also known as soul food. There are many fried and high-fat foods that are preferred, things like fried chicken, red beets, particularly fatty meats like spare ribs, use of pork fat for flavor. Sometimes a green with pork fat can be added. Macaroni and cheese. So in this instance, dietary interventions would include some substitutions of low-fat protein sources like poultry, fish, and beans, and low-fat cooking methods, baking, grilling, certainly barbecuing, which is culturally popular, boiling and stewing, and when frying, using small amounts of vegetable oil. I won't go over this in detail since the time does not permit, but I think you'll enjoy looking at this very culturally sensitive African heritage diet pyramid with some physical activity on the bottom and some preferred cultural foods throughout. My other example, very briefly, is the Asian American traditional diet in that it contains refined white rice, which is often eaten with every meal. So in this instance, dietary intervention would include portion control for rice. There have been efforts to convince elders to have brown rice, and it has not been very successful. So this is a perfect example of where you can use your food replica and show what a portion would be. And that can be very helpful. And also increasing vegetables to reduce the amount of rice on plate. This, again, is a food pyramid showing the Asian diet pyramid, again, giving you an opportunity to look at culturally preferred foods and making adjustments with that in mind. The most important thing is to individualize treatment. I'm going to repeat the excellent advice of Ms. Mendoza, my colleague, to consult a registered dietitian, an RD, or a certified diabetic educator. These are people that are experts in treatment of diabetes, particularly the nutritional aspect. Individual goals are needed, and this is where you need to have an expert. The major goal is to maintain blood glucose levels in normal range. And, of course, this is to reduce the risk of complications like heart disease, kidney disease, blindness, and amputation. Issues to address, and again, on an individual level, is there an issue of obesity, weight loss? Are there comorbidity considerations like coronary vascular disease, hypertension? The percentage of daily carbohydrate, fat, and protein intake. This needs often to be juggled. There is no one diabetic diet. And with that major goal of keeping blood glucose levels within normal ranges, this is where the individualization has to occur. The timing of meals and snacks, carbohydrate counting, which can be very helpful in spreading out and controlling the amount of carbohydrate at each meal so that they do not have these big spikes in blood glucose, food adjustments based on glucometer readings, exercise recommendations, and certainly medications. And to end my part, here are some resources I hope you'll find helpful. The Mexican My Plate Food Guide, this next from the USDA Ethnic and Cultural Food Guides. There are a wonderful array of different ethnic food guides, more than we had time to show today. Internet resources to locate food replicas. Strongly recommend this to help educate about portion control. The Excellent Food and Culture resource book covering extensive numbers of ethnicities. And lastly, internet resources to locate registered dietitians and certified diabetes educators. Thank you so much. And now we'll open it to questions.
Before we do that, I would like to just add a few things. I'm Nancy Morioka-Douglas, Clinical Professor of Family Medicine and Co-Director of the SGEC. Thanks so much, Ms. Mendoza and Ms. C. As a practicing family doctor, I always learn a lot other members of the treatment team. For those of you who may have had some difficulties in hearing these presentations, we will be making the audio portion of the presentation available at our website in a few days. Now, some of you may be wondering how you can use all of this information in your practice or at your training sites. Few have the luxury of having resources like Ms. V or Mendoza, especially during this time of doing more and more with less and less. One possibility would be to incorporate the information that they've presented within group visits or simultaneous medical appointments. For those who are not familiar with this concept, which is just such a powerful one in chronic illness care, I'd invite you to just Google. I think the best thing would be to do simultaneous medical appointments, since that's the one that you can more easily bill for. You might invite a clinical nutritionist or a certified diabetic educator to partner with your practice team to share this information. Now we have some time for the presenters to answer questions. If you have any, please use the chat feature located on the left side of your screen. And this is important. After the Q&A, we would like for each of you that are out there listening to us to answer the short evaluation questionnaire you will find on this last slide. Now let's see what people have been asking. So can Ms. Fee elaborate more on the timing of meals and snacks?
Yes, I wish I had a one-size-fits-all answer for you. It's an excellent question. This is why the patient really needs to work in an individualized basis with either a certified diabetic educator or a registered dietitian with special training. Again, because the the major goal is to keep the blood glucose levels within normal ranges, and there are so many variables if the person is sick or they've gone without meals, and that's where the complexity goes in. So again, I wish I could give you a nice crisp answer, but that I think is probably going to be the most helpful answer that I can provide.
I'm not seeing any other questions out there on the chat feature, so I'm going to ask one. I think that for those of you out there who are training health professionals or who are working in safety net clinics, we're all kind of scratching our heads about how best to address the needs of our patients who have financial barriers to getting the food they need or getting access to the supplies they need for taking care of their diabetes. For Ms. Mendoza first, and then Ms. Fee, do you have any tips about how you can help people with limited income in getting what they need, given that, you know, you had talked about, Ms. Mendoza, you talked about getting those prior authorizations. And for those of us who work in the trenches, it can be a very, very time-consuming process. Any comments about what we can do to help facilitate this?
Yes, hi. That is a very good That is an excellent question. You know, it's really hard, you know, prescribing medications for the patients who we know are going to have a difficult time attaining the medication, especially if it's a medication that is not on formulary with the patient's insurance. And then we know that the patient is going to be, you know, stuck with a big payment for the medication. So therefore, we have to really advocate and fill out the prior authorization or medical justification forms for these patients so that they can get the medication that they really need at, you know, with the less cost, out-of-pocket cost for the patient.
I'm going to jump in here. This is Dr. Morioka-Douglas again. But I was just thinking that one of our valued specialty cohorts that we've worked with at the SGEC are pharmacists. And for those pharmacists out there, one of the things that I've started to do with my own practice is to partner with pharmacists who are working at pharmacies that a lot of my ethnic elders may go to. You out there may find that there are certain pharmacies, particularly those that are based in the neighborhoods that these patients come from, that are taking care of a disproportionate share of the Medicare authorization requests, particularly when you're ordering test strips or supplies that exceed what Medicare allows. And so sometimes what you can do is partner with your pharmacist, many of whom work as a primary caregiver for the people out in the community in terms of dispensing a lot of very valuable education. Maybe partner with them to help facilitate this process, because it happens over and over again in a day where you've got to get the information for your Medicare, Medicaid patient process. Ms. D, any thoughts?
Yes. Probably one of the best resources for getting food in general. I'm sorry. I'm starting again. One of the best nutrition resources particularly for low-income people, would be the senior nutrition program, and this is nationwide. And this is a program. It's located in certain communities, in all communities and community centers. You could call your area on aging to find out the exact locations wherever you are residing. But they do give a very nutritious meal. Now, this is not exactly fitting in with our diabetic portion control, so I'm not sure exactly how that fits together. But certainly if the person doesn't have enough money to get food, that at least is a start. And also if there are the meals on wheels, but I would recommend the area on aging in your locale. And also if you can connect with a social worker, I wish we had one right here. They are the ones that really can individually work with your patient and get them the services that they need.
Thank you so much. I'd like to thank our presenters for their excellent presentations today. Thank you to the audience for your participation. Please remember to look at that short evaluation questionnaire you will find on this last slide. Our next webinar in this series, Applying Best Practices to Diverse Older Adults, will be March 1st from 12 to 1 Pacific Standard Time. The topic will be delirium, assessment, and management. If you enjoyed this presentation, please be aware that completion of this survey helps Stanford GEC to continue to obtain funding for important educational programs. We invite you to visit the newly revised Stanford Geriatric Education Center website at sgec.stanford.edu to explore our other resources. This concludes our webinar for today.